Hey guys, Professor Bill, Comic Book University, and I'm back. I'm back for issue number 9. I like to call it issues because I always forget that it's actually an episode. Anyway, podcast number 9, guys. Let's break right into this. Oh, first off, you might notice something new. My allergies are killing me all week. They've just been absolutely killing. No, that's not the big thing. The news ticker. That's pretty cool, right? I just learned how to do that. I figured, I was watching the news, and I'm like, you know what? I would like to be able to do a little news ticker, a little news feed at the bottom of my podcasts. I think that'd be cool. And, tell me what you think, huh? Am I doing good or what? Anyways, guys, let's break right into this. We're going to be talking about Macy Williams. Did you guys hear they're going to be doing a New Mutants movie now? Like, it might wind up turning into a TV show, but as long as it stays in the production line of being a movie, Macy Williams from Game of Thrones, she played Arya Stark. You know, Arya Stark. Anyway, she's the one with the she's the little ninja girl, the youngest girl, and she got the face changing things and all, and the needle, the little sword, and all that stuff. That one. But what do you call it? She might actually be playing Wolfsbane. Now, apparently, the majority of the big wigs on the project. Now, mind you, that's important. That's important because this is Fox Studios we're talking about. They are. I want to say they're no joke, but they're like one of the biggest jokes. Right? Fox Studios, the guys who put out freaking that Ghostbusters garbage that just came out last year, the ones who put out that Fantastic garbage the year before that. Yeah, those guys. Look, the guys who are actually going to be in charge of the movie itself, talking directors, the producers, all that good stuff, those guys so far are pretty hot for having Macy Williams playing Wolfsbane. All right. But we don't know yet about the execs higher than that, all right? Like the actual people in charge of Fox Studios itself. Fox is most famous of all the studios you could imagine for walking into a set and saying, "Yeah, we're gonna change everything." All right? So, like, forget about those last minute script changes that the WB does, all right? Especially with their superhero movies, apparently. No, more specifically, they'll literally come in and just say, "Yeah, listen, this one third of the script, we don't like it. So we're going to switch this up." It's like we're in the middle of shooting. Literally, we've got 8 days left to shoot. What are you going to do? "Well, I think you better hurry up. Here, we're going to add in another director or two to help you out." They absolutely do that. They do that pretty much all the time. It's kind of ridiculous. But anyway, I just said ridiculous. But Macy Williams, man, if she's playing Wolfsbane, this could be cool. Now, Wolfsbane, I don't know if you guys are, not everybody's necessarily into the idea of the New Mutants. Back when X-Men was everything and anything mutant was just poof off the chain. The idea of mutants was great because here is a way now for Marvel to be able to say, "Listen, here's this really great superhero idea that I have. He can do this or she can do that, and she's from here and he's from there," and all these different things. Okay, how did this individual get the superpowers? And if you're talking about a whole team, maybe they all fell into a nuclear reactor. It's hard. That's like the hardest part of any story. But when they came up with the idea of mutants, boom, they were born with the powers. They developed around puberty. That's it. And they've all got powers. That was genius. Seems so simple, right? But the easiest thing in the world. So they start making everybody mutants, right? All the new characters are mutant, mutant, mutant. All right, everybody's going to be a mutant. And the with Wolverine, oh, he's just a guy with claws, and he claws at people. Cool. What's his origin story? He's a mutant. He's got claws. They originally thought that he was going to have claws in his gloves. They just turned it around. It's a well, what should we give him? He heals very fast. We'll say that. All right. Actually, he was going to be strong like Spider-Man and not really much else. Actually, and originally before that, he was actually going to take the shape of a Wolverine. And before that, they were actually thinking about calling him the Badger instead, the Honey Badger. Can you imagine that? So, anyway, the idea is that the new mutants were just more mutants who came along. And they said, "Oh, yeah, here, we've got these mutants, and they're working for Professor Xavier also. They're the young, new group." So this way, kind of like, you got WWE and you got NXT over here. Oh, WWE, they got a whole bunch of people on the injuries list or a whole bunch of people quit. Okay, bring up some of the talent. right, from down here that we've been training. Same thing, New Mutants, they were supposed to eventually come up. Well, what eventually wound up happening with them is they turned into the X-Force instead. And oh, thank God they did, because they were amazing when they turned into the X-Force. But the New Mutants actually had a pretty good loyal fan base. It, like, I'm not saying like a cult following, no. They were actually a pretty big deal at the time. They had a whole bunch of cool things going. In fact, the next set of the Marvel Heroes Legends stuff, like case in point, let's look at my stuff up here. Can you see my X-Men stuff up there? Yeah, you can. What do you call it? That stuff there, that was the latest group right there. Juggernaut is down there. When you combine those guys, not Storm, when you combine those people together, they form the Juggernaut, you know? And then that's the wave one. Wave two, that should be out, I thought it'd be out by now. You're actually supposed to combine them all and form Warlock. And Wolfsbane is supposed to be one of those characters, I believe. I know Colossus is one of them. He wasn't any mutant. But the idea is that, yeah, they were actually a fairly big deal. So having something like this could be cool. Now, she hasn't herself confirmed it, mostly because she hasn't said that she's actually going to go with it. And we'll see. That actually is a pretty big deal, because the X-Men movies haven't been that great lately. They really haven't. We really have to see what Logan looks like. Even if Logan is great, even if Logan is fantastic, it's supposed to be way, way in the future. And the next X-Men movie is supposed to be like in the 90s, you know, something along those lines. Even if it's the best movie that's ever been made, Logan, it's not really going to tie back to that. You know, they're going to have to find another way to bring X-23 back there, or just recast Wolverine himself, Logan. So, I don't know. But if they're getting good actors, actresses, hey, man. I mean, look who was just playing Jean Grey in the Age of Apocalypse. What's it called, Age of Apocalypse? X-Men Apocalypse. Anyway, the X-Men Apocalypse, Jean Grey, that was actually Arya Stark's big sister, right? Sansa. So, hey, man, keep it all in the family, right? And just as long as Sean Bean isn't there, because I have to cut off his head. Anyway, so moving on. Let's talk about Batman and how mad I am at Batman, all right? Look, when I say I'm mad at Batman, it's mostly tongue-in-cheek, all right? But, like, Batman is one of my all-time favorite heroes, all right? Some people are going to be upset when I say this, but Batman is essentially the Marvel character that DC owns. That's the way I look at it, because while all the DC heroes are just, they're gods. And that's really what they are. They are the gods. I've said it so many times, they're the modern day mythology. They are not heroes to emulate. Marvel are the heroes to emulate. DC are the heroes to idolize. I can never be Superman. I can never be Wonder Woman. I can never be these great, powerful beings who are basically like gods. You know what I'm saying? Like, amazing powers, not just amazing powers, but at extenuated levels, right? So where does Batman fit into that? Where does Batman fit into that mythos? He really doesn't, yet somehow he's supposed to hang with the big boys. So the problem that I've always had with Batman, and the one and only problem that I've mostly had with Batman in the comics, is that he'd be in the Final Crisis or any of those crisis, the big crossover events, and he'd be leading the teams and doing something crazy or, you know, something amazing, and yeah. But then in his regular comic, he'd have a hard time fighting the Joker and Bane and people like that. And it didn't correlate well. And that's why I've always said, in fact, I just did my my most recent Batman comic book review, and I said that Batman's got to be in a bubble. And I mean it. I really mean it. Batman and the Bat family, all of them have to remain in a bubble. You got to kind of act like they don't exist in the same realm as the rest of the heroes. You want to just make them in a parallel universe, hey man, by all means. But for the most part, you got to keep them as separated from them as possible, because it just doesn't fit. So now the way that they've tried to reconcile that is the idea that, oh yeah, man, here's Batman, but he's not as powerful as he used to be. Okay, that's cool. That's cool. Because realistically, Batman being like, you know, the every time you have some kind of versus battle, okay, this guy versus Batman, that guy versus Batman. And the question's always, either Batman will just trounce this guy, or, oh, Batman versus Superman, Batman versus Wolverine, Batman versus God. The question you always come up with is, how much prep time does he have? Like, who cares? Who cares? Or as much prep time as the other guy has. How's that for an answer? It's always the thing. Well, how much prep time? Who cares about the prep time thing? All right? If this character you don't know about or you do know about, who cares? The other guy's got the same amount of prep time. Now what? Batman shouldn't be one of those guys who can take on Superman and beat Superman. He shouldn't. All right? Look, Frank Miller did that, okay? Frank Miller, hot off of Daredevil. Right, made Daredevil into what eventually Batman would become. While Daredevil was the guy who was in the shadows, had the little horns, and he'd pop up with the shadow and scaring the hell out of people and beating the crap out of people and have dealing with life issues, actual life issues. Batman was over in DC with Robin and the bright, colorful blue with the cool gray, and he was basically Adam West, and there was Burt Ward on the side as Robin, and Cesar Romano was running around, woo, and all that crazy stuff. I'm going like a lunatic here, right? Burgess Meredith as the Penguin, Frank Gorshin as the Riddler. Met him, very cool guy. Look, the idea is that Batman was a joke. He was a joke back then. He was very fun and lovable and blah 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 blah, all right? And Catwoman was always hot, all three of them. But the idea is that he was an absolute joke. You can't, go ahead, argue. You can't, all right? He was a cartoon character, literally. But when Frank Miller had his fair share of Daredevil, he came over and made Batman into Daredevil. I know. Bill, you can't say stuff like that. Batman's Batman. No. Batman became what he made Daredevil already. All right? Daredevil was what he was before Frank Miller went over there, turned him tight, turned him tough as nails. All right? But he didn't get the popularity, didn't get the exposure that Batman would have. Guys, sorry, my allergies really are kicking here. But the idea is that, Batman was a joke and Daredevil didn't have any real fan base, not the way that Batman does. So when he had the chance to come over and do Batman, he basically made, he did for him what he did for Daredevil, but he had more of a following. He was more famous, right? He had more exposure. So what happened now? Now all of a sudden he goes and has this great storyline where, amongst other things, he beats up Superman. That's sick. That was lit. Nobody expected that, and that's why it was so amazing. But so far, Batman has fought Superman more times than it's been approximately 15 times. It's been round about 15 times, and Batman has won every single time. And it's just not realistic. And it made people into this crazy thing. Well, Batman could beat Superman, then he could beat anybody. That's not true. Batman knows that Superman has very specific weaknesses. Wonder Woman doesn't have those weaknesses. He's never beaten Wonder Woman before. There's been lots of times I've read comics, I own comics, where Wonder Woman has wiped the floor with Batman, just playing around, training, whatever, but okay. So no, Batman can't beat anybody. He can't beat everybody. He can't. Superman has a very specific weakness that Batman is able to exploit. All right? And that's why. And more than that, he has the power of plot. And he usually carries that plot in his belt. You know what I'm saying? Like, well, let's see. The only way Batman's going to win is if he happens to have this one particular item. Well, we don't actually label what's in the bat belt. So, bing, the utility belt, he's got this plot device. He's got this MacGuffin that he's going to be able to beat up the bad guy with. Batman is great. He really is. But they did make him too overpowered. So, nowadays in the comics, that they've kind of not dumbed him down. We'll get to that. That they've made him kind of a bit weaker now. I'm actually good with that. I'm totally good with that. The problem that I have is that they made him dumb also. Not dumb like stupid, but rather he's not as quick. He's not as alert as he would usually be. All right? First off, they're not really portraying him. But like there's what, four, five, six comics that have Batman in them now? Batman has more appearances in the comics than any other superhero ever. That includes Superman. All right? Batman is everywhere. So Superman may be more popular. He is. He absolutely is, and for good reason. But Batman has more actual appearances than Superman. I don't even know what to say about that. And he's always come up and he's done something really cool. But now, making weaker. I'm good with that because he is supposed to be human. He should overcome with his smarts than anything else. He's supposed to be the second smartest guy on Earth, right? First is Lex Luthor, then is Batman, then is Mr. Terrific. And then go on with whatever you want to go on with after that. But making Batman not so smart anymore, getting punked out by Amanda Waller, getting punked out by Amanda Waller again, just getting punked out all the time. Bane, I just did the most recent Batman comic book where I was so upset that Batman goes out and he says, I'm going to take down Bane. And the way that he takes down Bane is he goes to the place where he knows he's going to be and he waits there. And if you look at the clock in the background on both panels of the show, it, he waited about 3 hours for Bane to show up. In that 3 hours, Bane went around and beat up 4 of his friends, captured them, and held them out as display, so now Bane has the upper hand. Now, I don't know how they're going to fit this. This is Tom King writing this in the actual Batman comic book, not Detective Comics or anything else. I don't know how they're going to fix this, but Tom King really has to fix this. I really need to see that. I don't care if Bane wipes the floor with Batman. I'm okay with that. What I'm not okay with is that Batman, the world's greatest detective, air quotes, decided to be a detective by making a stakeout for 3 hours. Bane's going to show up here, so I'm going to wait here for him to show up. He's a man of his word. I'm sure he'll show up eventually. Instead of going out and trying to get the upper hand on him. That, I honestly, the comic just came out this week, so in 2 weeks, I guess around March 1st, right? Yes, March 1st, the new comic should come out. I demand to see that Batman actually had a really cool plan. All right, maybe he had an LMD sitting over here. We'll get into LMDs in a moment. But that's what I want to see, because I'm not cool with Batman getting punked out in any way, shape, or form. Okay, guys, moving on. Captain America's Secret Society is set to come out this summer. All right, it's wintertime right now, so we got another season and a half to go, and the Secret Society comes out. Now, what Secret Society is, Captain America number 11 just came out, so that means that several months ago, when issue 1 came out, we discovered that he actually hails Hydra, all right? He's all like, you know, hail Hydra, rah, and he's a bad guy, because Cubic, the sentient cosmic cube, all right? If you don't know what a cosmic cube is, you know what? I should make a in-a-minute video about that. Because, yes, you know what? Bang, I think I shall. You'll be seeing Kingpin and Juggernaut coming out this week. Maybe at the same time that you see this drop. Who knows? But the idea is that we've got a sentient cosmic cube under the control of the Red Skull, brings Captain America from his old man form with the super soldier serum, you know, pulled out of him, into the super soldier again. Young again, because super soldier serum doesn't let you age. Excuse me. And he's got a whole new history now, where his mother was recruited into Hydra. And therefore, Steve was raised in a Hydra boarding school. And his plan now is to take over the world. But as a side plan, he decided that he's got to not only take over the world, but take over Hydra specifically. So he's got to dispose of the Red Skull. Very interesting scene, because you know what? Like, too often, we know that Captain America is at the physical peak of what a human being is capable of. Therefore, he is absolutely in the superhero realm. All right? He is absolutely a superhero, because if you just, you know what? It's an existentialism. Check out Nietzsche. And check out existentialism. There's the 5 tenets of existentialism. One of those tenets, I think it's the 3rd tenet, we will never be at our peak physical, at our peak anything, because it's just simply not possible. The super soldier serum allows that to happen, right? If you take a minute to rest, that's a minute that you could have been doing something, engaging with your life, literally, you know, doing something special. The fact that we sleep, the fact that we have to use the restroom, it's taking away. So even if you redouble your efforts to make up for that time, you're not making up your time, because you could have redoubled your efforts at any time. and gotten even further ahead. So we'll never be at our peak possible potential. That's why Captain America is so amazing in that regards. But it's not just his physicality. It's also his mentality, right? His brain is a part of his body. So he is absolutely at a genius level. In Marvel terms, it would be considered Remarkable 30. So not quite Iron Man level, which was Incredible 40, not quite Reed Richards level, which was Amazing 50, but Remarkable 30. That's same as like Professor X, right? That's more than Doctor Strange. He's a very smart guy. He absolutely is a genius. He's just not super genius level, like I said, Stark or Beast. Beast, Hank McCoy, is considered to have a Remarkable 30 intelligence. Captain America has a very similar intelligence to him, IQ level, let's say, but he chose to go down the range of tactics while Beast went on the way of biochemistry. I think he mostly did biochemistry. I know Henry Pym did biochemistry. I think that Beast did the same thing. That's why he mutated himself, and the other Beast went the magical route, which is blows my mind. Anyway, so Captain America is a super genius, and in these comics, we get to see Captain America actually being that super genius. I love it. I love it. Because you get to see him plotting and planning and his tactics and the overall strategy. And it's amazing seeing him do these things. The problem is he's a bad guy. It's killing me. It's killing me. He's my favorite character. He's my absolute favorite character. You know? Because all the comics have made you, if you read a whole bunch of comics, especially in like the 80s, you know what I'm saying? All those comics were saying, Captain America's the best. So, I was brainwashed. It's propaganda, man. It's all propaganda. But anyway, so, and go figure, I wound up studying marketing amongst many other things. So this is coming out. He's finally going to be revealed as a Hydra agent. I was talking earlier about an LMD, getting to that right now. LMD is Life Model Decoy. If you follow Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. or follow me watching Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., you'll know what an LMD is, all right? Life Model Decoy. They came out in the 60s in the Nick Fury Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., Agent of S.H.I.E.L.D. comic. Really, that was when he got promoted from a sergeant all the way up to a colonel. He somehow went from NCO to officer to O. Good, don't ask me. But the idea is that it is a thing that was developed by mostly Tony Stark, perfected by S.H.I.E.L.D. scientists. I think AIM had something to do with it too, if I remember correctly. But anyway, the idea is that it is a perfect android simulation of a specific human being. And it is supposed to take the place of that human being in a particularly dangerous situation. And it's supposed to believe it actually is that human being. So that there's no way to know otherwise, right? Immune to any kind of detection abilities. There's no reason why you would not think it's not only a human, but that human in question. Nick Fury used them all the time, all right? There was one time that I remember Maria Hill using it, and it was an awesome display. But she actually referenced back to Nick Fury. But a whole bunch of different times where they've used LMDs. And here we have the LMD of Ant-Man, the fourth Ant-Man. They like to say the third Ant-Man, but technically it's the fourth Ant-Man. Eric O'Grady, he was the irritating Ant-Man? The irredeemable Ant-Man. He was kind of irritating too, but he was a total scum. He's the guy, he had like 10 or 12 issue miniseries. It was actually supposed to be a full series, but it didn't really do that well. He really was scum. Right around the World War Hulk time, he lost his comic, canceled, and then he joined the initiative, the 52-state initiative. And he's had a couple interesting times there. Particularly, he had a good time with Taskmaster. So here we have, in the most recent couple issues of Thunderbolts and Captain America number 11 specifically, a few other comics around, we get to see that the Red Skull found that crashed ship where in the first issue of Captain America, Steve Rogers, issue 1, where we're on issue 11 now, it crashed, and that's the one where he proclaimed Hail Hydra. He kicked Jack Flagg out of the the ship, and he and Dr. Selvig, you'll remember him as the crazy guy from Thor, the main doctor guy, and he went crazy in Thor 2, Dark World. Dr. Selvig, anyway, him and Baron Mordo, Baron Mordo was supposed to be in the tomb, and he faked their deaths. And he took the black box, but as it turns out, lately they know that people are going to steal the black box, so they put two black boxes in there with their video recorder and everything. So Taskmaster, when he actually found the second black box, and he looked at it, and he saw Captain America doing the whole Hail Hydra thing. So he's like, well, this is interesting. And he went to his cohort, the Black Ant. Now, the Black Ant, because I know a lot of people, this is the reason why I'm bringing this up, because a lot of people are asking me, you know, Bill, Professor Bill, I say, Bill, who the heck is this Black Ant guy? Black Ant is an LMD of Eric O'Grady. Eric O'Grady was killed, but somebody made an LMD of him. And that's who the Black Ant is. It's an LMD of Eric O'Grady, the irredeemable Ant-Man, the technically fourth one. So, interesting, right? So these two guys know that Captain America is actually a Hydra agent. So they're probably going to be the ones to expose this. But if not, Agent Coulson is also, yeah, that's right. He's in the comics too. All right. He started off in the Avengers movie, like the first Iron Man movie. He started off there in the movies, but he was so beloved they had to bring him to the comics. So Agent Coulson is doing his own little research and he's tying knots and he's like, wait a second, what's going on here? Oh my God, no, my hero. So sick, right? Sick stuff. All right, moving on. We've got Mel Gibson. What am I at here? Oh, 26 minutes. Let's try and tie this up. Mel Gibson, apparently he has the green light to direct Suicide Squad, the sequel. So Suicide Squad Part 2, that's right. He really wanted to work with Mel Smith. That's probably when we're going to start calling them Mel Smith. But Will Smith, he really wanted to work with Will Smith before. And just the stars didn't align for it. And now he's saying, you know, dude, I really want to work with Will Smith. And they're saying, well, he happens to be doing Suicide Squad 2. Would you like to direct it? Because his last movie was a hit, multi-nominations and whatever those Golden Globes, Emmys, one of those shows that I don't watch, the award shows. And basically, he talked about doing it, and a few other people also in charge of the studios doing it. This is a very similar thing to the whole Macy Williams thing with Wolfsbane and the New Mutants. Very similar thing here, where a lot of people are talking. They're talking on Twitter. They're talking behind the scenes. They're doing a whole lot of talking. And it's not just like third party. You're hearing it. No. You're hearing a third party. If you didn't hear it, you know, if you didn't read it online like I did, you're hearing a third party now. Go look at it online and you can see for yourself. So then you're basically getting it, I guess it'd still be third party. Anyway, you're getting it through the actual news instead of through Comic Book University news. The point is that he's apparently all but signed. He's not actually signed, which means that it could fall through. It could fall through. The reason why they're letting this leak is because they want to see if there's going to be a public backlash. Because remember, he's an anti-Semite. I don't know what else to say about that. Like, there's, everybody knows, you get somebody drunk and have a conversation with them, you're going to find out what kind of person that guy really is. All right? And many times that guy was drunk. Look, Mel Gibson's made some great movies. I loved him as, you know, when Lethal Weapon, right? Loved a whole bunch of things that he's done. But facts are facts, man. There's nobody trying to guess it. He said it himself. So, whatever. And multiple times. So, anyway, that's that. I want to really quick talk about, moving on, Captain Planet is actually really being done. Oh, my God. Like, it's actually being done. Leonardo DiCaprio, also at one of those similar or same Emmy award shows, whatever, that I don't watch, right? I don't know which one of them. Could be the MTV Kids' Choice Awards. I don't know. But the idea is that he's actually really making a Captain Planet movie. Now, Captain Planet came out when I was a teenager, like a high school teenager, and I never watched Captain Planet, all right? I would turn the channel, and that would be on, and be like, oh, cool. Wow, cartoons took a real nosedive ever since I stopped watching them and moved on to MTV or something, you know? Oh, man. So, yeah, he's apparently really doing this. Now, look, if Leo DiCaprio is really big on the environment, so if he's doing this, it obviously means something to him. It obviously means a lot to him. The question is it going to be good? Here's the deal. Besides the beach, name something that he was not good in. My point exactly. So there's a really good chance that he could be good in this. That even if he's not, in it, and he's just, directing it, whatever, this could actually be good. And if he pulls this off, guys, you know what this means. That means everything is fair game. We're gonna get a Mask TV show. We're gonna get a Thundercats movie. We're gonna get He-Man Master of the Universe coming back. They've been talking about that for a long time. Leo's gonna come out. Somebody's gonna come out and kick down the door and be like, "Hey, Leo did freaking Captain Planet. We're doing Masters of the Universe." And we're gonna have Thundercats versus He-Man. Thunder by the sword of Grayskull. Thundercats ho and fighting with the sword of omens and the what's his sword? The sword of eternity? Anyway, so the idea is that, dude, if Captain Freaking Planet gets pulled off, I mean, Power Rangers are about to come out. That trailer looks good. Oh man! And now Captain Planet's gonna come out. If Captain Planet is good, move over all the other movies because that means any movie can be made. We're gonna get a My Little Pony live action movie, and all the bronies are gonna go nuts. All right. Hey guys, and welcome to our comic book science segment. Now, last Tuesday, the CIA just released documents, classified, they declassified them, that they've actually been trying to use telepaths for some time now, long time ago. Now, being former military, I knew that the military used to do this, and we've actually had movies that have indicated exactly the same thing. Now, the problem is this actually possible? Could they have actually had real telepaths? Well, they wouldn't have released it if they did. But, there's always the thing between Russia and the States trying to do that, and I'm sure other people try to do that too. But the idea here is that can it actually be done? And that was the question that was given most recently. Can telepathy actually be done? Well, we can refer this to a comic book character and say, yes, absolutely. Even in today's modern science, if you look at some of the experiments that are being done to the present day, we are able to make a helmet that can register the bioelectric field in order to make a robotic limb actually move. So we can control it with our brain simply by thinking, not using eye movements or anything, only the bioelectric containment parts of our brain. So if we're able to do that, somebody like Magneto, he has actually demonstrated that without his helmet on, which prevents telepathy either way, he's actually able to use telepathy. Not nearly to the level that Charles Xavier can, rather about a tenth of that. So he uses that simply by detecting the magnetic field around the entire Earth, and then he goes directly to an individual and he'll be able to read, translate the bioelectric signals coming out of a person's brain. Sounds really weird, right? But the truth is, it could actually be done. It's already been done on a tactile form, but the idea of doing it through electromagnetic field detection, yeah, why not? In the future, we could absolutely do this. We've already got the possibility, just not the means. So it's kind of like reverse engineering a really good idea. All right, guys, so that's the podcast. I hope you enjoyed it. Make sure you check me out on SoundCloud also if you're just looking to listen in the car or in the Walkman. People ever use Walkmans anymore? So the point is, the iPod. Anyway, seriously, I hope you enjoyed it. Make sure you check out some of my other reviews for comic books on the channel. Make sure you check out some of my storylines that I put out. And also, don't forget to check out the Explained in a Minute series of videos. Juggernaut and the Kingpin will be going up probably today or tomorrow. Anyway, guys, Professor Bell, Comic Book University, class dismissed.